Hey, Jay, welcome to the One Away Show.
Hi, Brian. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's my pleasure and delight to be on.
Well, it's been a long time coming, watching our relationship grow, and really excited to have you here. So, you know, Jay, I've known you a long time, as I mentioned, and you have a lot of incredible experiences, and I would love to dive into, you know, one or two of them on the show. So what would you describe as your one away moment or experience?
Without trying to go rogue on you and commandeer your model, can I give my two away?
We can do two, one at a time.
Okay. So there were two that really transformed my perspective. Actually, three, but two were business and one was personal. So I can do the two, and if you want the third, be happy. The first one was back when I was about your age, and I did the work for the company that became Icy Hot, the product that everybody knows about today. It was a mail order company, and I learned about things that have denominated my life: lifetime value, marginal net worth, allowable cost, and the fact that a lot of major media firms had unsold advertising, and if you could win their trust, you could get them not to charge you for it, but to be partners in the result the advertising produced. Those three or four elements together were transformative to my life. I was able to understand that, utilize it, build a company from almost scratch to $13 million with no marketing cost in about a year and a half, build 500,000 repeat buyers. The company was not mine, but it was sold for $60 million to, pardon me, a major pharmaceutical company. It created my stature. And then the second happened about 10 years later when I was running Entrepreneur Magazine. I was not running the management, I was doing the marketing and strategy. And I retained who was at that time the first or second most famous guy in his corridor on direct marketing. And he taught me more about lifetime value. He introduced me to reason why marketing. He introduced me to massive thinkers in the marketing world, people like Claude Hopkins and Albert Lasker and George Hoskins and David Ogilvy and John Caples. And that immersive knowledge, coupled with what had happened 10 years earlier, exploded my understanding, Brian, of how to reach people at the depth of their impact points ethically in their mind's eye, and to compel them to really trust whoever I was representing, the client, and be open to responding to whatever the actionable proposition we made. And that was the beginning of an explosive era in my life that transcended from Entrepreneur Magazine, newsletter business, investment business, and it kept evolving. But those two activities really changed and redefined forever my life.
Both of those are really impressive, Jay. And you know, I remember when I was in your office in California when I met you for the first time, and I think it was an hour meeting, and I think it turned into I walked out 3 hours later, and it was such a vivid conversation. And I remember you speaking to me about AC Hot and as the first one. And so maybe take us back to AC Hot. We'll go into the entrepreneur and maybe find the connective tissue between the two and how that helped you transcend forward. But with AC Hot, you know, What did you really learn? It sounded like it was such an explosive growth period for you as an individual. How did you get into that opportunity in the first place? And what was your involvement to really help it succeed and sustain the growth it had over the period?
Yeah, it's a great question. So it was quite accidental. I was the accidental marketer. I was young, uneducated, had two kids, no job, looking for opportunity, had been involved in lots of different industries, not necessarily successfully, but experientially. And I knocked on the door, and the guy that owned the business thought I was interesting, and he took me sort of under his wing, let me hang out with him. And then finally he said, I've got this business I bought and it's almost dead. It was an old line mail order patent medicine company that sold this product that was for arthritis or bursitis. The product back then sold for $3 a jar. So it was many, many years ago. It was sold by mail order, but the man bought it very, very cheaply because it was getting ready to go broke. And he made a discovery that he shared with me, and that was that everybody who was still actively buying, they weren't marketing and they hadn't for years, but the active buyers bought over and over again at least one unit every month. And he tracked their purchasing, and they were long-term, years and years. And then he tracked the purchasing and saw that for every 10 that bought, 5 bought another product from the catalog. And for those 5, approximately half bought bulk every year. And the analysis proved that every time you got 10 brand new $3 first-time buyers, $30, you were accruing $50 of profit every year for each. So $30 of initial first-time sales would produce $500 of annual profit, and that profit would keep continuing over and over again for life until somebody died or there was a cure for arthritis. And he taught me that there were lots of radio stations, publications, magazines at the time, all kinds of other advertising formats that did not sell all their available ads. And that if you could come to them with a viable enough, believable enough, credible enough, compatible enough proposition, they would be willing, if you knew how to do it, to run those ads for you without payment, but instead convert their compensation to a share of the results. He had an idea that was very, at the time, breakthrough. The product sold for $3. Our cost back then was modest. 55 cents to make it and to ship it out, believe it or not, bulk rate, long ago. It was $2.45 in real profit, but he proposed that I get on the phone and call as many radio, TV, magazine, newspaper, media sources as possible and set up joint ventures, performance-based, where we paid them 115% of the first sale. In other words, instead of paying advertising, we said every time you generate a $3 sale, we'll give you $3.15. And that was unprecedented. And I was able to, over a long period of just tedious effort, which I don't know that I could repeat today, I was able to get almost 1,000 different media sources to do it. Almost none did very big volume every day, but the cumulative effect of 1,000 media sources selling 3, 5, 10 a day, each one a brand new buyer, are that you're accruing thousands of new buyers every day. 80% are going to buy over and over again. 50% of the 80% are going to buy other things. 50% of the 50% are going to buy bulk. And we just kept doing it and doing it. So he taught me that if you know the allowable cost you can spend. And very honestly, as I turned out and got more mature, I realized we could have spent a lot more. If we know we're gonna make $50 a person in year one, spending $345 to get a client is very low. If we had cash flow or we could borrow money, we could have spent $49 to get a $3 sale and still made out, you know, $1 the first year and $50 year 2, 3, or 4. But he taught me not to look at the moment, but to look at the residual value, the lifetime value, the marginal net worth that a buyer is representing to you, or a prospect, or a lead. And that was really, that was a profound to me.
You know, Jay, what's, you know, one of the things I've gotten to know with you as we've sat down over the years is what a strategic thinker you are. And I guess my question to you is understanding those principles then about understanding your cost per acquisition and then the lifetime value, it showed you a very clear strategy that could exponentially blow up the valuation of the company. So my question on more of a personal note is, was that one of the first times in your life where you were exposed to more strategic thinking about how to kind of navigate through problems, or did you always have that muscle and maybe it just hadn't been used?
Yeah, I really actually probably had it latent, because earlier in my career, I had worked for Schick Shavers, electric shavers. And it's a boring business, a non-exciting business. And I was able to figure out a way to get one of our retail clients, a big drug chain, hundreds of thousands of dollars of advertising for almost nothing, just by seeing connections that no one else had seen. But I didn't have the basis. It was just sort of intuitive. When I got explanation and confirmation and quantification and was able to see all the factors come together, the light went on for me, and it made it much my understanding and my ability to commandeer that power source became multiplied many times over.
Got it. That makes a lot of sense. So, and then also, I think as we go into that, Jay, I think something I've always looked up to you is, you know, and we'll get to your entrepreneur experience, but I don't want to
get
over this. You've always understood content, and you've always understood how to get to people. You know, when you were doing the sourcing of the media placements, how did you know where to go to find the right outlets that would find you guys the customers that would buy over and over again? And did you have any way of measuring it back then?
That's a good point. Well, process was interesting. I mean, in any, you know, any kind of advertising environment, you know that there's certain media that has your demographic profile. So that wasn't hard to macro identify, but the ones that were receptive was another story. So I started just cold calling and being not very effective. But then I realized, and I identified companies that were already doing performance-based marketing, and I started contacting people there and getting introductions to stations or radio, TV, newspaper, magazines that they were working with, because it wasn't competitive, and I gave them a residual on what came to me, and that became an accelerator, because they put me in touch with people that I already knew had a open-minded prejudice towards doing deals. And then it started happening very rapidly. In the beginning, it was slow, arduous, a lot of rejection, but then it became much more powerful. And with each cluster of media that I was able to do it with that worked, we had more validation, more proof of concept, more references. So it became easier and easier as we got more and more critical mass to do it.
Yeah, that sounds like any good product that once you develop and it gets a bit of fire under it, it can keep going. And
yes,
helped mastermind it all. Well, Jay, okay, the company did very well. You figured out how to get it to market and then it sold. Is there any other pieces from that experience that you
Yeah, there were two other pieces that were quite profound. So the company that bought it was a very rigid pharmaceutical company that owned consumer products. Oh yeah, two things. We started as a mail order company. I forgot this, but I got so much free advertising exposure nationwide that it accidentally and unintentionally created retail distribution. People started going to their grocery, their drugstore, you know, and saying, "Do you have ICIOT? Do you have ICIOT?" They didn't. They called us, and accidentally, we moved from a mail order product to very heavily a retail product. And why that's very important was back then, today, an online company is more valuable than, a brick and mortar type. But back then, a mail order company was worth X, not a lot if you wanted to sell it. A consumer product that was distributed in retail was worth 10X. So it accidentally made the company worth $60 million instead of six. So that was an interesting lesson. The last lesson was fascinating about rigidity of paradigm and very, very limited, a sort of tunnel like. We had to agree not to compete in that category, but they didn't want the 500,000 repeat buyers. They didn't want any access to the almost 1,000 media distribution. They just wanted the brand and the retail outlets. So we were able to go right back, use our 500,000 buyers, our 1,000 almost radio television, the over 55 market, and it cost us nothing because we'd already sunk cost building it for Icy Hot. So that was interesting.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I think I'm gonna have my, I'm making a note in this, Mike, you kind of cut out, and I'm gonna have my editor.
I'm sorry.
No, it was weird with the connection. I'm gonna have my
editor. Yeah, it is, it says it's good. I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. Could you maybe, DJ, this is for you to make a note to cut out. That's for my engineer.
Okay, fine.
So, let's go back, Jay, for the retail and the distribution. Let's go to the second point that you made. I think that you're right. The online businesses today, they are worth more. But I think what's interesting, though, even if every business today is an online business, but so depending on the product that's sold, getting into the stores is a really big deal. And I think what you're saying is if you can create enough demand and word of mouth from people, your strategy really helped create a market or a new market to go into because you created so much demand through another channel by getting-
That is correct. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Touché, you're right.
So very interesting. All right, well, let's move forward to your second one away experience to entrepreneur. And if there's anything in the middle of that, we can definitely touch on it.
Well, they did lots of things before that, but entrepreneur was really interesting. So anybody that has ever read Entrepreneur magazine today, it's a different model than it was when I started. I actually started right after it first came out. When we first started, this is dating me, Brian, but nobody even knew what the word entrepreneur meant. We had to send out our promotional pieces in envelopes that had Webster's dictionaries, both definition of an entrepreneur and the phonetic way you pronounced it because people were not familiar with the word. So that's how far back I go. But it used to be, I'm sorry, go ahead.
For context, for the audience, what year was this?
76, 75, okay. 6.
Great.
So, its original format, it was a $100 a year membership organization. It got, as a member, you got certain benefits, a plaque, discounts on things, a membership card. And then every month there was a magazine formatted membership newsletter called Entrepreneur that had as its main attribute a 20 to 30 page feature report in the middle on an emerging small business opportunity. Back then we introduced tune-up shops, salad bars, yogurt stop shops, all kinds of different things. And it would chronicle, first of all, what the investment would be, what the yield would be, risk, cash flow projections, recoupment, who the best franchisers were, how you do it yourself, if you wanted to not franchise. But every month when it was the end of that month, it would just go into archive. We did nothing with all of the content, all the editorial content. When I got there, we had plenty of old editorial sitting, and I took a lot of the 20, 30 page member reports, we added to them what I call boilerplate, just stuff you need to know to hire an attorney, get permits, if you're going to buy fixtures, do guerrilla type marketing, and we turned them into startup manuals. And we ended up with a couple hundred startup manuals ultimately that we sold for $39 a piece. And when I started, we had a membership that was generating about $1 million a year. It was very modest, but we ended up selling almost $7 million of reports that were just repurposing our content. And then we took the reports and we aggregated them by category. We would create the Entrepreneurs Institute, which would be the top 12 food-related or service-related or low investment businesses or automobile or whatever, or professional services. And we would sell that for $200, and it just became on and on, but it was all leveraging up. And it was a concept somebody taught me called redeploying the same asset and repurposing it many different ways for almost no extra cost.
So similar to what you see today on social media, but 40 years ago, you were taking the original content from the magazines, right? You were selling it to the consumers, but then you were packaging it into reports or, you know, what they call as...
Go ahead.
No worries. And so, what was, I think, profound back then, 40 years ago, was taking the initial content and then packaging it into insights and then selling that again in multiple ways.
Give me one second. I'm sorry.
No worries.
Good. Okay, go ahead.
But
you're right. No, that's what we did. It was really profound. It was, I've been blessed to have experiences that were really strategic concept altering, and lots of things ended up flowing from what we were able to do in our arenas, or what I was able to learn from other arenas. And geez, that was an explosive time for me. It wasn't huge like $1 billion, hockey stick thing today, but we grew, 900% in 9 months, and it ended up being sold for tens of millions of dollars too. I never had equity in it, but I got some nice rewards for it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's something about you, is that you do have these experiences. I almost identify in a way just all the things I've done, and then I'm finally settled into something, but each experience has taught me so much at a big level, because I've had to fully throw myself in, and you bring all those things into one thing and you can build something really interesting. But back to you, is, this reminds me a bit of a platform called The Mighty. It's an online platform, but they take the content from contributors and then they have insights and then they sell that to brands. So my question to you with Entrepreneur, when you're packaging up these reports and kind of creating these new business models, who are you selling these reports to from the repurposed content?
Well, as we happen to hit a beautiful window when entrepreneurship was starting to take off, and I was selling it to people who wanted to be entrepreneurs, part-time, full-time, existing entrepreneurs that wanted to expand their portfolio of businesses or shift into new businesses. The headline that we used in the beginning was, who's really making a bundle? And it was identifying all these sleeper opportunities that no one else knew about and proving that they existed and they were emergent, and showing people the good, the bad, the ugly, including risk level, capital requirements, recoupment time, ROIs, all those things. And it was way ahead of its time because it was not real sophisticated, but it was enormously advanced for its genre.
So Jay, from that experience, I would say is you maybe step away from the tactics, right? And you step away from what actually happened. If you kind of pull yourself out and you look at that experience objectively now, I think if our audience listening to this, there are a lot of young professionals, people who maybe want to be entrepreneurs themselves, or maybe already are, but probably skew more in the first two buckets. It sounds like both of these experiences, you threw yourself in and you found ways to make it work. What's the type of advice that you would provide to these individuals who are looking to maybe find the path a little faster as you kind of found yours through these experiences?
Well, my life has evolved to where what I always tell everybody is that the hardest thing in the world is to bring the first buyer in. If you have any kind of a repetitive product service, or if you don't, if you're smart, you'll find other ways to get utility value out of that kind of buyer, other complementary products, extension products, service products, if it's a prospect, even competitive things if they don't buy yours. But if you're going to do that and you don't have either a lot of capital or you have a limited market you're penetrating or a limited way to do it, find people who already spent a lot of time, effort, money creating access to the market, trust to the market, credibility to the market, and partner. I mean, you'll never find a better time than now to structure collaborations, partners, joint ventures, endorsements, referral, co-branding deals. And if you know how to do them, geez, they can shorten the timeline. They can move fixed costs that you don't have into variable. I mean, we've done tons of, I did $250 million, $250 million of seminars when I was younger. And my fixed cost to do it was about $300,000 that I paid over time. The rest of it was either reciprocal. I did something for them and they made that audience available gratis, or I gave them a small share on performance. But I mean, you can do all kinds of things if you understand the power of partnering.
Absolutely. When you say that, can you maybe go a little deeper? So if I'm younger, right, and I want to get experience, are you saying, hey, I should find people doing really interesting things and go work for them, or partner with them on ideas, or a combination of the two?
Well, you can do two things. You can partner with them if you've got something. You can figure out what market they've got and what product or service they're not selling, and then bring them and be the middle person, and not just do finder, but put yourself right in the middle. You can, I'll tell you a story that relates to that in a minute. You can take their products to other markets or distribution channels or influencers and take a very generous piece of the business if you can explain to them allowable costs, repurchases, lifetime value. You can take what they do, if they only do it in one market, take their IP, whether it's marketing, process, selling, and then license or partner with other people to use it. I mean, I can go on and on and on, Brian.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think it's been a strategy for me in different ways, but from a business perspective, from a partnership, I think that's another way to do it, to get involved. Jay, one of the things I want to maybe go into is, you said at the beginning of this call something that kind of caught my attention that was really profound. I think you said with Entrepreneur, you really started to figure out when you were there, you know, it was a very explosive experience for you, but you figured out how to really get into the mind of the consumer in a very tactful way. And really they drive human behavior. And I think if you can understand human behavior as a marketer, you know, you can really get the results you want that are mutually beneficial. So could you maybe speak to that a little bit more clearly? Because I think for, you know, people out there trying to figure it out, right?
Sure. Absolutely. Sure. So the first thing you have to realize is when you are advertising in any media, it doesn't matter, Facebook, Instagram, radio, TV, I mean, a platform, you have to realize it's being seen, read, watched, listen to one human being at a time. It's not me talking to a million people, it's me talking to a million individuals one at a time. So you have to have the you attitude. It's not about me, it's all about you, number one. Number two, before you start, you have to realize that value and definitions differ from any two people. Right now, you and I are having a conversation. You're being very respectful. I appreciate that, but I can promise you that half of the language patterns and the words and the meanings that I have in my mind and the visual experiences of those meanings are totally different than yours, not because I'm brighter or less bright or you, it's just that we've had different experiences, different definitions. So if you're gonna basically have to operate in a world where value and definitions are going to be critical, you better figure out what they mean. So the first thing is you wanna spend time trying to examine, evaluate, understand, appreciate, acknowledge, and respect how your target audience sees life. Hmm. Now, the hardest thing for most people to do is really understand what's going on in their mind, but there's a simple way to do it, and I'll give you one of my many proprietary techniques, and this is pretty powerful. I call it the Amazon.com School of Business, School of Marketing, School of Research. If you really want to know how to speak to the audience you want, the way to do it easiest without looking for divine intervention or trying to just arbitrarily come up with something or doing a focus group, which may or may not be accurate because you're not asking them to spend money. You're just asking for a superficial response, not a transactional response. It is that you go to Amazon.com to start with. You look at any books in the direct category of what your product or service does or anything related. You look at the titles and subtitles of the successful best-selling 10 or 25 books each year for the last two or three, because most books sell more on the promise and the premise than they do on the content. You look at the chapter titles because that will show you what resonates with people. You can even look at the index. Then the big windfall here is you look at the reviews. You look at the zeros and you look at the fives. The zeros are the most negative. The fives are the most positive. People don't realize, Brian, that when you are passionate, and passion has two gradients, positive passion, negative, angry and happiness. When you're very passionate, your subconscious will tend to override your conscious. If you've ever heard anybody who's thrilled or pissed, they have, when they're not using vulgarity, they come up with really cool word phrases and concept expressions that are profound and right on the money and very clear. So if you go through a lot of these analysis and you see, first of all, you see promises and premises, which are the headlines in the chapter. You see positives and negatives and you scrape them from a lot and then you put them into categories. You can do the same thing with review sites. You can do the same thing with general review sites of services that are generic. You can do it with ones for specific competitors or alternative means instead of your product or service, some other kind of product or service that addresses the same problem or opportunity. Now you've got word phrases that tell you exactly what people want and what people don't want, so you can really speak to their mind's eye. You can say, I know you want this and this. I know you don't want this and this. I know you want to be able to blank. I know you're tired of not getting blank. And you can speak right to them if that makes sense.
It makes a lot of sense. It reminds me a lot of this book I'm reading, or almost done with. It's called The Laws of Human Nature by Robert Greene. Familiar?
I'm familiar with the author, not the book.
Well, anyway, it's really about how do you tap into the subconscious of people, right? And drive human behavior around it. And essentially what you're saying is, what are people saying? And like really studying them to understand how to speak to them in a way that matters, which makes sense. If it's, let's just go back to your experiences at Icy Hot, going back to your experience as an entrepreneur, as a marketer and advertiser and someone who's trying to like really figure it out, you really had to like compel people to kind of take action on the things that you were saying and believing. And because you're able to do that, you found success with the products that you were helping advertise. And the product itself, I'm sure, was really good, but there was a reason, you know, you had to cross the front lines. And I think that kind of underpinning as a framework and learning that over the years has really allowed you to kind of succeed with whatever you're selling, even though it's a good product. It's like understanding the person.
It's very insightful. Thank you. I think it's very important to also, this is something I learned long ago. It's called the Aikido School of Business. And Aikido, if you don't know it, or if you do know it, I'll tell it for everybody listening, watching, whatever. It's a martial arts category that uses the power of the enemy against the enemy. So the concept here is you take any negative and you turn it into a positive. You don't avoid it. You know, if you say, well, you might not think this is right for you. We understand that. That's why, you know, we want you to know this about it, that about it. And that's also why we won't even consider your purchase binding on your side until you've experienced it for 30 days and you've seen this result and that result. Or if you're trying to get hired, you can say, I wouldn't hire me yet until I talk to lots of people, but I would make a point to put me, you know, into the circumstance for a day and let me observe it. Let me see whether I even think I can add value. Let me ask questions. Let people ask questions of me, things like that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think it's well said, and it comes from a good school of thought, and the negative to positive and kind of play into that with people and understanding, you know, it's really about situational and relational awareness and kind of how to respond, because not everything is so rigid and the adaptability
right.
behind
You're right.
So, Jay, these experiences have been incredible. I think they really give me an understanding. I mean, I know you, but really can understand some of the things about you I didn't know and why behind them on a professional level. Did we want to go into the personal one, or is that something we want to do on another?
Yeah, episode? I can share that. It's pretty profound. So I was lucky. I got started very young. Wasn't lucky in having to do it because I was married with two kids and no education when I was very young, but it turned out very wonderful. And so I made a lot of success and money correspondingly when I was young, and I made it in different cycles. And I went through three midlife crises, one at 40, one at about 50, one at 60. And the first two, I made money and I was looking for salvation, happiness, and it didn't come. And I was really traumatized. And one time I went through a bad divorce and it took all my money. And so I was really traumatized. And I would go to therapists and I'd do these 55 minute sessions. And right, Brian, in the midst of coming to a realization or a breakthrough, they'd go, oh, your time's up. We'll continue next week. And it was a cliffhanger that I loathed. So the last time I bought the therapist for an entire week at a time. And my deal was, look, I'm going to come when I'm ready. And we're going to just talk through until we get to conclusion or we get to pay dirt. And in the meantime, I'm going to send every screwed up person I know who probably would never seek therapy since I'm paying you. And it was hilarious because I had lots of screwed up people and they would never go on their own, but they got great solace, but not because of the normal therapy that was 55 minutes that I would say, hey, I can't do it today. You guys go for 3 or 4 hours and talk yourself till you're done. But I got one thing out of it through very deep and exploratory cathartic discussions that forever has changed my life. And what it was this. The guy said, look, Jay, most people are focused on the end product. They want to make trillions of dollars. They want to have the biggest house, the fastest growing company, the billion-dollar exit, the hottest wife, the most toys. If they're unlucky enough to get that for that reason only, the skies aren't going to open, the angels aren't going to trumpet, nirvana and euphoria is not going to rain down on you. It's not going to happen. It's anticlimactic. It's just going to be zeros on the end of your challenges, problems, and oftentimes even multiplied exponential stress and frustration. He said, the real meaning of life is the process, the interaction you have with everybody, old, young, wealthy, pauper. Everyone has value. Everyone has perspectives. Everyone has different hopes and dreams. And if you learn to appreciate everybody who compositely makes up life, business, companies, audiences, markets, buyers, clients, you will fall in love with every day and every interaction. And that forever transformed my life. So that's the personal one.
Yeah. Maybe Jay, I think, can I go deeper on that?
What? Right.
Okay, whatever you're comfortable sharing.
Yeah, sure.
Why do you think you were chasing money or the end goal? It sounds like when I met you, you seemed very aligned in the sense of from the inside out.
I am now. I am now. But I think because I came from a very modest family, I had to work three jobs when I first got married because I had no negotiable skill. You know, I couldn't even afford a car when I first got married. I had to take the bus. When I first had my first child, I left the door unlocked and someone stole the car seat and I couldn't buy a new one for a month. And I had enormous contrast desire to have all the things that I didn't, because I thought that was going to make me liberated, happy, in charge, euphoric, because that was my reference model. And I wanted things. I wanted, you know, when I first made a lot of money, I had Ferraris and Jaguars and Rolls Royces. And when I was single, women, and I did everything you could imagine, first class, and was wild. And none of it really gave me a very lot of joy. It just pissed away a lot of opportunity costs, a lot of money, and a lot of energy, and probably a lot of quality experiences that I would have had and could have had if I had a different reference paradigm.
Okay, really meaningful. I have so much to say, but I wanna ask one more question if I can. Sure. Go a little deeper.
Yeah, go ahead.
Let's say you maybe discovered kind of the things that you know now about yourself to be true. If you knew what you knew now then, maybe at 40 or 30, how do you think maybe your life would have been a little different, or the path that you were traveling been more meaningful or enjoyable? Like, what are some of the actions you would have taken that would have been different?
Well, I mean, I think that I would have been a better husband, father, friend. I think I would have had more balance in my life. I think I would have less negative reflections about my conduct. I think I would have been a much better investor, because I never was a good investor, and I would be a better choice of character in business associates. I had some very painful, bad sociopathic partners early in my life that burned me very bad because I was an idealist. But I don't know. I mean, you know, they talk about young, you know, there's the adage that youth is lost on the young. I have a belief system that for most human beings, you don't learn through listening, you learn through experiencing. And I think that you don't know what you don't want to, you don't know what you want, excuse me, to experience what you don't want. I think anybody who could help anybody else shorten the pain and the learning and the timeline curve, geez, you're doing the most noble service. But I think you have to be in the right place, in the right receptivity. And sometimes your influences. In other words, I didn't go to school, and I'm not saying that with pride. I think there's certain disciplines and that you get from education, even if it's for something that's totally different than what you go into in your life. I think that there are lots of experiences you need and lots of influences you need to formulate the right, let's call it portfolio of character traits, of beliefs, systems, of mental models that will give you balance, certainty, secure mental security, because security is nothing more, Brian, than the faith, confidence, and trust you have in yourself and your ability to perform. There's no security in a job. There isn't always security in a business, because you can always be obsolete, be competed against, you know, make one, you know, one lapse of judgment. So there's a lot of things that I've learned at a very, late in my life that I would love for, because I have children your age, younger, older, that I wish I could instill in them. I try and they listen, but I don't know that it really penetrates. I think they have to go through their own life experiences. But, I was never a good investor. My kids all invest. They don't invest massively, but I always thought that my life would be achieved just through my personal performance. And I've been very blessed. I've made a lot of money and made people a lot more. But I think I would rather have done things differently. I mean, but on the other hand, geez, I've been around the world 80, or figuratively, not everywhere, but 80 or 90 times and never paid for it, gone first class. I've had, the ability to, spend days on end on public interacting with guys like Tony Robbins and Damon. I've had influence over people around the world, and I've got to see and experience things very few would. So, you know, I'm grateful for all the good, and I'm reflective of what could be different. But I think you have to look at your life always in context. It can always be worse, can certainly always be better. But if you make the most of whatever you've got, not the least, life is a fascinating, pardon me, adventure. And there's a quote somebody said, it's not always fun, but it's always fascinating.
Oh, Jay, the answer is so real and vulnerable and valuable. I'll respond to that in the sense of not saying I fully understand, because I'll never be in the shoes that you are in, but I did.
But I won't be in yours either, so right. It goes both ways.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I had a great dialogue. I was lucky in a sense where I grew up in. My parents had a lot. We weren't super well off, but I think we had enough to get by. I mean, dinner was never an issue. Going to college was it was a pretty.
Yeah.
But I saw a divorce at a young age, and I think seeing a family ripped apart, that was hard. And I think what I said to myself was, I looked at my parents and their career paths, and they've done well, but I looked at it and I respect them. I think they've done an incredible job as parents. And I said, can I be happy with my career? Can I be happy with a personal life, but also have it all with a career and be fulfilled at the same time? And so when I went to college, I think I might've told you this in California, but when I went to college, I said, how can I find the thing on a personal alignment level that I can make a lot of money from, or make good money from, to support a family and have a really meaningful relationship? And I feel, you know, had these two existential questions of finding work that I'm really aligned with, that I can build on, and then the personal side of life of how do I do that really fulfilling. And so I think with your answers, it's very validating of, you know, the path. It's just I saw things a little differently and you saw things differently growing up, and the way we experience life is completely different, but kind of similar conclusions in different ways. And so, you know, I think that's what's beautiful about your story and what you're sharing is, and my dad was similar to you. He grew up with nothing, absolutely nothing. And he's the hardest worker ever. And so I think he'd resonate a lot with similar things you said. And so I just really appreciate you sharing and being so vulnerable with us.
Oh, my pleasure. I hope it has value.
Yes. So, great value. I think the audience for this, they appreciate the life lessons along with the business lessons. I think that's
great. No, it makes me happy. If I can make a difference and give some clarity and some expansive perspective to people, gee, that's wonderful.
Absolutely. Well, Jay, thanks for coming on and sharing your experiences today. And just excited to share this with everyone.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you. I mean, I have been wanting a bigger forum to a younger market, and I think you have that, so it pleases me very much. I've been blessed to reach a lot of people that are 45 and above, but I haven't had the ability or taken it to reach the people that are younger, that I think if they understood some of these belief systems might dramatically enhance and advance, accelerate and elevate what they achieve and what they get out of that achievement.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'll make sure to spread it far and wide with the youth under 30 and make a difference.
Great. Thank you. I very much appreciate it.
Absolutely. Goodbye.